Hello, Malty. National fans of maltific malts. And thank you to Jacob Anderson for providing the malt mention for Ralfy Review 869. There you go. Extras. It's an extras, you see. Because I don't have a bottle of malt on the table. If you haven't called by before to the Bothy, welcome. I'm Ralfy, in the Bothy, somewhere in the middle of the Irish Sea, enjoying a little bit of peace and quiet and a nice little juicy West Coast dram just to wet the whistle and keep me focused on providing you with useful information to help you with your whisky purchases. Now, I've had a number of messages recently saying, Ralfy, where do I start with independent bottlings? Now, in Ralfy Review 868 extras and 867 extras, I've already provided some information to help address this big, powerful question, which seems to get problematic when folk are buying out there, wondering if they're making the right purchase. Because it's easy to get it wrong. Whiskies are not matured equally. Casks can vary considerably, even though they're made of oak and not exceeding 700 litres. The variety of oak cask interactions with spirits is absolutely astounding, far greater than you might believe until the moment when you start to experience them. And for your experience, some of them are going to be great, very enjoyable, almost unforgettable at times. But with others, you're going to be wondering what on earth's going on in this cask, because the signature that you recognise from an official bottling is almost invisible in the nature and the flavour of the whisky. And you get that. It's not unusual. So I'm going to give you some more information now. And I want to put it in the context of private investigators. You see, private investigators are very good at sitting at a desk, going online and checking here, checking there, checking lots of everywhere, looking for background information on what's happening out there. And as time goes on, the internet's very good at providing that, in particular for whisky. And it's not just Ralfy Reviews. There's plenty of other reviewers out there doing a damn good job in their own individual way, and more power to them. But something which you will rapidly become aware of is that you can buy a book and it'll say, this is a great whisky, that's a great whisky, and that's a great whisky, and here's a list of great whiskies, and they're generally official bottlings. And it's a good place to start. But as your journey continues and you become more adventurous, which so many malt mates are, see, things have changed so much over the last decade or so. It used to be, when I was a kid, that people stuck to one brand, they were brand loyal. And that was the flavour that they bought for themselves as a special treat, whether it be Glenfiddich, bottle of Bells, bottle of Teachers, bottle of Famous Grouse, bottle of Macallan, bottle of Glenfiddich. There wasn't that many options out there, and people tended to stick with what they knew. But so much has changed now, and people are exploring. And one of the best ways to start is to give yourself a good grounding for a couple of years with official bottlings and get to know the house style. And you can write your notes down, do your tasting notes, that's good, it helps with the mental focus. Now I'm going to take a particular whiskey, Kulila. And I'm going to take Kulila as my example here because it's the most available peated Islay malt to be found in independent bottlers. And the official bottlings aren't outrageously expensive. They're accessible and they're available. So as regards a peat malt, single malt experience, Kulila is what I would call dependable, Don't get me wrong though, malt mates, there are bad versions out there. I had an appallingly bad version of Kalila matured in a sherry cask, and I think the sherry cask must have been a bit stale, and that was from an independent bottler, one of the biggest ones. And I kept that bottle. So you never waste a bad whiskey. You always keep it in standby so that you know exactly at any time of day what a bad whiskey actually tastes like. And you never know, your bad whiskey might taste quite nice after you've had it on your shelf with a cork off it and on it for a couple of years. There's no rush to finish your bottle of whiskey when you buy it. If you want to keep your whiskey going 10 years, you can do that with a little bit of inert gas in it. Perfectly doable. So with the official books and, you know, original experts that write books, you'll get a good introduction, but they're not very good at picking out and giving analytical assessments of specific versions of whiskey. This is where you have to go online, and two of the most significant sites, and I'm not including my own here because I'm being modest about this, is whiskeyfun.com, still highly relevant, which is the single largest articulate whiskey archive on the internet by far. And in its favour, it's been consistent over the years. Now, I don't necessarily agree with all the reviews that Serge and Angus at the site give, but I can applaud them for their consistency. Another site is Whisky Base, which is quite a large site, a lot of contributors there. And sometimes the word is that it gets a little bit loaded in some assessments of some whiskies. But bear in mind the sheer volume of whiskies that are reviewed and marked and archived. It's another really quite important site. And I think that the administrators, in fairness to them at that particular platform, do a pretty good job. But I'm going to go back to whiskeyfun.com. And I mentioned Kalila as my example. Now, this is where you start to put on your private detective hat. You go to the Kalila section at Whisky Fun and you print off a copy of the list of independent bottlers. And first of all, you know how many bottlings of Kalila they do. So, for example, if it is official bottlings, well, plenty options, and vintage options as well. But Adelphi, for example, we've got 9 versions of Kalila from Adelphi who are pretty reputable. And what you're going to do if you've got the time and the space, you're going to have a look at the marks that have been provided and just write them down beside it and look for the patterns. Does Adelphi have a series of really good Kalilas? Or in fact, is it signatory? Perhaps it's Gordon and MacPhail. Perhaps it's Douglas Lang. Perhaps it's Hunter Lang. Perhaps it's Cadenhead. Or perhaps another independent bottler or one of those independent bottlers gets a consecutive series of poorer marks. Remember, the actual spirit is identical in the official bottlings as to what's in the independent bottlings. What is varying is 1, the casks and their influence, and 2, the storage provenance. Are they stored in big warehouses or in little dunnage warehouses with plenty of fresh air around them and a little bit of damp? You want that. So here we have Cadenheads, loads of bottlings of Cadenheads. I've had a few Kalilas from them. One or two were not good, some were excellent. What I noticed with Cadenhead was, if it was in a bourbon cask, it was fine. But in a sherry cask, not good. Therefore I knew if I was buying from that independent bottler, just check out the bourbon cask selection. Now, I have been asked, and I'm going to address this question yet again. Hang about, Ralphie, some independent bottlers provide their own bespoke custom casks to the warehouse, to the distillery to be filled for them. Therefore, that suggests that they're using better casks. No, it's not, malt mates. Let me explain. It may be the case that they're using better casks, but it may be the case that due to their warehousing policy, whether it be high rack systems or palletage, they need all their casks, whatever the spirit in it, to be the same size and the same capacity so they can be more conveniently stacked. That could be the reason why they're providing their own casks to the distillery to be filled. Just sharing what I'm here to do. Duncan Taylor, I used to buy a few bottles from them, but I don't buy anything from them now. Dunvegan, I have to say, bit hit and miss. Exclusive Malts, yeah, they did some good ones. They seem to do older versions of Kulila, which originally were at reasonably accessible prices, but as everybody else pumped the price up, so did them, and hey, it's business. We've got Gordon MacPhail, loads and loads of bottlings from Gordon MacPhail. Hart Brothers, very few. Helen MacArthur bottlings, well, I've only got one. Do you know there's hundreds of independent bottlers, but most of them only maybe bottle one ever, or small release now and again, maybe a dozen a year, because it's a hobby business or it's part of another business, it's just a branch of another business. It could be whiskey importers, distributors, wholesalers. They just want to have a little bit of their own independent bottling so as that they can diversify their portfolio of business interests. Hunter Lang, not too many. Jack Weber, Whiskey World. There's a few here. Generally older, and as far as I'm aware, generally reasonably good quality. And here we go to James MacArthur, independent bottler, going for younger whiskies. There's only one which is significantly older at 25 years. Kingsbury certainly has had a good reputation in the past, but no wonder when you're bottling Kulila 30, 23, 36, 37 years old. So some independent bottlers bottle older stuff, others bottle younger stuff. Some have a kind of mixture, but it's mainly young rather than old. It really depends where the market is and who they're selling to, because there is not one whiskey consumer. There is different families and groups of whiskey customers with different budgets, different aspirations, and different expectations. Murray McDavid, haven't bought anything from them for a long time. And then Samaroli, who have not bottled anything for quite a while, but highly sought after. A gold standard independent bottler. Signatory. Now, loads of Signatory stuff. Signatory can be really, really good value in the UK. I don't know what it's going to be like where you are. It's your experience. But I tell you what, if you're careful, if you do your private detective and cross-reference, because this is where you're starting, you're mapping out what's the opinion on these bottlings from several directions. Then you're going to phone your friends, you're going to interact with online forums and perhaps join a whiskey club, and then finally you're going to arrive at the door of your specialist whiskey retailer and find out how truthful they're being with you. Now and again, if your budget covers it, be prepared to take a risk. Say, buy a bottle of something like Imperial. Very obscure distillery. Doesn't get mentioned much. Isn't highly rated, but it bottles some beautiful, beautiful, genuinely exciting, refreshing, different malts. You buy that the way you'd buy Royal Brackler, the way you'd buy Tamnivullen independent bottling or Glenallachie independent bottlings, because you're getting a genuinely refreshing, authentic characterful whisky, which is going to give you more than the official brands can, because official brands, the official bottlings, the house style can become too important than the singularity of personality. Do you know what I mean by that? And your palate will take you there. It's all part of the journey. Wilson and Morgan, I think they mainly bottle in the US. I'm not quite sure, but I don't come across them very often in the UK. You have independent bottlers that are based in Holland, Germany, France, Italy, and increasingly you're getting retailers with their significant contacts with distilleries and warehouses. And because they have leverage because of the amount they're buying and selling, being a retailer, they will bottle their own under their own in-house label. As you probably know, even small, privately owned, one-shop, independent retailers will have their own in-house bottlings. And it's a sense of pride to them that they get it right. Because if they're going to bottle it, they need to be able to sell it, particularly if they're selling it in their own shop. It's not a good look if they're not selling their own whiskey in their own damn shop. But the online retailers as well, the big London-based ones, they are bottling at the moment some very interesting independent bottlings of really good quality, because they have the reach to get the better casks out of the warehouses. It's self-evident. You know I'm telling you the truth here. And then, of course, then you have guest malts. So you have a small distillery in the US who's building a loyal following. And they've got a lot of people on their mailing list. And they say, hey, folks, our distributor is importing some Scotch whisky. And we've arranged to buy one barrel of this Scotch whisky, which we so select, and we shall bottle as our guest malt from Scotland. And then tell you what, we're going to twin up with a Scotch whisky distillery, and we're going to send them a cask of our bourbon that they can bottle and sell exclusively at their Scotch whisky distillery. Because we've got, it's like towns around the world twinning, joining up for a little bit of ambassadorial good accord. This is happening with businesses, and it's a smart move. And you don't hear it anywhere else, but you hear it at ralfy.com, because I hear about these things. So there you have, you're going to be printing off a bit of paper, by the way, but keep a hold of it, because it becomes a historic archive. Very interesting. For the Kulila list from Whisky Fun, it's about 8 pages long. But once you start making your own notes and applying the scores, and then scores cross-reference with Whisky Base, you will start to develop a much clearer picture of what is what. And then you can transfer that to another single malt. I'm Ralphie, sharing the knowledge, because you're a malt mate, that's why. If you've enjoyed this, I don't say this very often, but I'll mention it now. Subscribe if you haven't. Click the bell for notifications. Leave a thumbs up. I know a few folk leave a thumbs down automatically as soon as my videos go live. And hey, that's fine. If some troll wants to give my video a thumbs down, probably without even looking at it, because it's just their way of showing how much they care. And do you know what? I appreciate the focus and the attention. I do. See you soon, malt mates. Bye.